Hello learners, welcome to K-12 Aspire. So this is the second lecture of chapter number 1, Electric Charges and Fields. In the previous lecture, we had discussed about what is charge and important fundamental properties of charge. In today's lecture, we are going to discuss about Coulomb's law, and together with that, we are also going to solve some important numericals. So let's start our today's lecture. Okay, so let's start our today's lecture. In the last lecture, we had discussed about the basics of charge and the important fundamental properties of charge, quantization of charge, then all different other properties, then how two charges behave, how they repel, attract and all that. In today's lecture, we are going to discuss a very important law related to charges, that is Coulomb's law. Okay, so first of all, we'll be discussing in detail about Coulomb's law. And after discussing Coulomb's law, we are going to solve numericals based upon that. We'll be solving few important numericals. And apart from that, you can also practice more questions from your textbook. So let's start our today's lecture with Coulomb's law. Okay, so what does Coulomb's law say? Coulomb's law is basically about interaction between two charges. Till now we have discussed only about one charge. Okay, so what is charge, then what is the SI unit of charge, then charge is scalar quantity and all that. Now, when two charges come near to each other, we know that when like charges come to each other, that is when positive and positive charge come near each other, or you can say when negative and negative charge comes near each other, we know that there is force of repulsion between them. And when there is the interaction between two opposite charges, positive and negative charge, then there is force of attraction between two charges. Okay, so there is attraction and repulsion. Now, Coulomb gave the law in which he stated that when two charges are going to interact with each other, then how the you can say effect of one charge is going to have its effect on the other charge. Okay, so the force between the charge 1 and charge 2 will be given by Coulomb's law. Okay, is given by Coulomb's law. So let us consider charge Q1 and Q2. This is charge Q1. Let us assume this is plus Q1 charge and this is plus Q2 charge. Okay, we can also consider plus Q1 charge and minus Q2 charge, or you can say minus Q1 charge and minus Q2 charge. We can consider any. So first of all, for the first example, let us consider two positive charges. So because of the presence of any one charge, there will be the force to the other charge, and we know that as these two are positive charges, so because of that there will be force of repulsion, or you can say repulsion between these two charges. So because of this charge Q1, there will be a repulsive force on charge Q2, and because of this Q2, there will be repulsive force on charge Q1. Now, according to Coulomb, the force between or you can say the line of action of force will be the line joining two charges. So let's say this is a center of first charge and this is center of second charge. So the line joining these two charges will be the line of force. Okay, so this was Q1 plus Q1 and this was plus Q2. So this will be in this direction. This is F force on particle 2 due to 1. And this is force on charge. This is force on charge 2 due to charge 1. And this is force on charge 1 due to charge 2. Okay. So this is like this. Now these are point charges. Okay. So during his experiment, to calculate that what is the value of this force, The Coulomb actually performed an experiment, and what does he found that? He found that this force is proportional to the product of charges. This charges Q1 and Q2. So first of all, he found that this for the more is the magnitude of this charges, the more is the force. Okay. Then together with that, he also found that this force is proportional to 1 upon r square. What is r? R is the distance between these two forces. Okay, so r is the distance between these two sorry charges. So let us first of all write what is F12 and F21. Okay, so what is F12? F12 is force on 1 due to 2, and the direction is Fx along F force F. This force Fx along the line joining center of two charges. Okay. And we can see that the direction of this force F12 is opposite to that of F21. F12 is in opposite direction of F21. Okay. But we have to notice here that they are opposite in direction. Sorry. But same in magnitude, or you can say equal in magnitude. Equal in magnitude. Okay, so F is proportional to Q1 and Q2. F is proportional to 1 upon r square, or you can say F is inversely proportional to r square. And together with that, he also found that F is this force between two charges is dependent on medium. F depends upon medium. So the medium can be any. These two charges can be, you can say, for example, placed in vacuum, they can be placed in air, they can be placed in water, or they can be present in oil or any other liquid or any other fluid, or you can say any other solid. Okay, so this force also depends upon the medium. So he concluded that based on these three observations, he concluded that the value of this force is equal to K Q1, or you can first of all write F is proportional to Q1 Q2 by R square. Okay. But together with that, he also found that F is dependent upon the medium. So there is the constant, which is K Q1 Q2 by R square. Okay. Now this K is constant. And K depends upon medium. Okay, and the value of this K is 9 into 10 raised to 9. Now, if we want to find the unit, so what will be the unit of K? We know that unit of F is Newton. Then K, the unit of Q is Coulomb. We have discussed it in the previous lecture, and R is in meter square. So unit of K will be Newton meter square per Coulomb square. Okay, and this K can be calculated as 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0 as per the Coulomb's law. Now what is epsilon 0? It is permittivity of vacuum, or we will discuss epsilon and what is relative permeability in the later part of this lecture. Okay, so till now, first of all, we are going to calculate how these forces are actually calculated. So we found that if we draw the graph of force between two charges, then it is inversely proportional to r square. Okay, this is r. Okay, so if the distance between two charges gets doubled, if the distance gets doubled, then the force between those two charges will reduce by 4 times. Okay, so you can calculate in that magnitude. If it gets 3 times, then the force will reduce by 9 times. If it gets 4 times, then the force will get reduced by 16 times, and so on. Okay, so let's just write, if r gets double, then the force will reduce by 4 times. Okay, so this is the formula of Coulomb's law. Now we can see that this formula is going to give us the magnitude of force, but in actual we know that the force also have direction. Okay, so this is just the magnitude. If we say F is equal to K Q1 Q2 by R square, then by using this formula we can calculate magnitude, but we know that force also have direction. So now we are going to discuss Coulomb's law in vector form. This is the simple formula which we can use in solving numericals, but this is going to give us the magnitude. Now what about the direction? So we are going to write Coulomb's law in vector form. Coulomb's law in vector form. Okay, so now we have to find the direction. So let's say we are considering the previous example that we have just discussed. These are the two charges Q1 and Q2. So we are going to find the force with its direction. So how can we write it in vector form? Sorry, F12 is equal to, first of all we are going to write the magnitude, K Q1 Q2 by R square. Into, now what here we are going to write it over here, we know that to write the direction we are going to multiply it with its unit vector. Okay, so the direction will be r1 vector minus r2 vector, means one from 1 to 2. Okay, so this was q1, this was q2. This was the distance between it. This is the line joining two charges. This was F21. This was F12. This is mod r, means magnitude of this distance. So if we go from 1 to 2, in the direction from 1 to 2, then it will be r2 vector minus r1 vector. Okay. And if we go from 2 to 1, if we come in this direction, then this is r1 vector minus r2 vector. Okay, so F12 vector is equal to kq1 q2 by r square into unit vector, that is r1 vector minus r2 vector cap. This is how we represent the unit vector. Okay, now similarly we can write F21 vector is equal to k q1 q2 by r square into r2 vector minus r1 vector cap. Okay, in 11th standard we have studied that what is the unit vector of A, that is equal to vector A divided by magnitude of that vector. So this, in the same way we can also write this unit vector, F21 is equal to k q1 q2 by r square. Now this is r2 vector minus r1 vector divided by mod of r2 vector minus r1 vector. Okay, now this r2 vector minus r2 r1 vector mod is equal to, first of all write this as, this is mod. Okay, this is the magnitude and together with that we have multiplied the unit vector. This is equal to mod r vector. Okay, so here we can write it as k q1 q2 by r square, or we can write it here as r2 vector. We can write this in this form, or we can write this in this form. Anyway, we can write. Okay. R1 vector divided by, we can write it over here, divided by R2 vector minus R1 vector cube. Okay, so this is the formula. Similarly, you can also write F12. F12 vector is equal to F12 vector is equal to K Q1 Q2 divided by R1 vector minus R2 vector cube into R1 vector minus R2 vector. So in this way we can calculate the force between two charges together with its direction. Okay, so sometimes they are also asking in vector form, so in this way you can represent. Okay, now let us discuss that what is the similarity between Fe and Fg. What is Fg? Fg is the gravitational force between two masses. Okay, so that we have already studied in 11th standard, but now we are going to make comparison between electrostatic force between two charges and gravitational force between two masses. So how they are similar and how they are dissimilar, or you can say what are the differences between them, that we are going to discuss. Sometimes they ask in your boards. Okay. So first of all, let us discuss what is the similarity between Fe and Fg. Okay. So what is Fg? First of all, you must be know that. You must know that. What is Fg? Fg is equal to G M1 M2 upon R square. And what is Fe that we have just discussed? In magnitude, we are writing K Q1 Q2 by R square. Okay. First of all, this formula that we have written is for the force between two charges in vacuum. And in other medium, we will be discussing in subsequent section once we discuss what is permittivity. Okay. So this is Fe. Okay. So here we can see that both of these formulas of forces are inversely proportional to the distance between their two bodies. They can be two charges or they can be two masses. So first of all, let us write. Similarity is inverse square law. That is, F is proportional to 1 by r square, or you can say F is inversely proportional to the square of distance between them. Now, what is the second similarity? We have observed that this charge between two particles is the line of action is passing through the center of the line joining the center of those two charges, and in the same way, force between any two masses was passing through the line joining the center of those two masses. So the both of these forces acts along line joining the center. In the case of charges, there will be line joining center of charges, and in case of masses, they will act along the line joining center of masses. Okay, so these are the similarity. Now if this is the similarity, then how they are dissimilar, or you can say how they are different from each other. So what is the difference between डिफरेंस बिटवीन एफ ई एंड एफ जी. ओके, सो द वेरी बेसिक एंड फंडामेंटल प्रॉपर्टी दैट टू चार्जेस कैन अट्रैक्ट और रिपेल बेस्ड ऑन देयर नेचर, दैट इज पॉजिटिव और नेगेटिव. बट इन केस ऑफ ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स वी नो दैट द ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स इज ऑलवेज अट्रैक्टिव, दैट इज नेवर रिपल्सिव इन नेचर. सो इफ देयर आर टू अनलाइक चार्जेस पॉजिटिव एंड नेगेटिव देन देयर इज फोर्स ऑफ अट्रैक्शन, बट इफ दे आर अनलाइक चार्जेस नेगेटिव नेगेटिव और पॉजिटिव पॉजिटिव देन देयर विल बी फोर्स ऑफ रिपल्शन. सो द फर्स्ट डिफरेंस इज एफ ई कैन बी ऑफ टू नेचर, दैट इज इट कैन बी रिपल्सिव और इट कैन बी अट्रैक्टिव. बट एफ जी इज ऑलवेज अट्रैक्टिव बिकॉज वी नो दैट मास इज ऑलवेज पॉजिटिव, इट इज नेवर नेगेटिव. ओके, सो वॉट इज द सेकेंड डिफरेंस एफ ई एंड एफ जी. नाउ वी हैव जस्ट डिस्कस दैट देर इज वन कॉन्स्टेंट के, दैट के इज डिपेंडेंट अपॉन द मीडियम, बट एफ जी डज नॉट डिपेंड्स अपॉन द मीडियम. The फोर्स बिटवीन टू मासेस इज ऑलवेज द सेम इररिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द मीडियम. सो एफ ई इज डिपेंडेंट ऑन द मीडियम बट एफ जी इज इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ मीडियम. ओके, सो दिस इज द सिमिलारिटी एंड डिफरेंस बिटवीन एफ ई एंड एफ जी. ओके, नाउ इफ वी सी द मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ दिस टू फोर्सेस इन जनरल, एफ इज इक्वल टू के क्यू वन क्यू टू बाई आर स्क्वेयर एंड एफ जी इज जी एम वन एम टू बाई आर स्क्वेयर. Now, keeping Q1, Q2 and M1, M2 and R square aside, what is the value of K? K is 9 into 10 raised to 9 Newton meter square per Coulomb square. But the value of G is 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. So, if we see the force between two charges is very, very, very strong as compared to the gravitational force between them. Okay, so if we compare these two forces, we can say that electrostatic force is very high in magnitude as compared to gravitational force. Okay, so this is the comparison between electrostatic force and gravitational force. Now let us discuss few limitations of Coulomb's law. Limitations of Coulomb's law. Okay, so the first thing is the Coulomb's law is valid only for point charges. So if two charges of very high, or you can say very big size, or you can say in terms of magnitude, if they are very large in size, then this law is not applicable. So they are applicable for very, very small, or you can say point charges. These point charges can also very big in magnitude, but if they are very, very, very apart from each other, then in that case the charges will behave as point charges. Okay, so let us write the statement. It is valid only on point charges, not for extended charges. Okay, so if the two charges are kept very near to each other, those two big charges, then it is not applicable. Okay, so this was the first limitation. Now the second limitation is The Coulomb's law is only applicable on charges as at rest. If they are in rest position, then only you can apply Coulomb's law. If they are in motion, or you can say if both are in motion, both the charges are in motion, then in that case, Coulomb's law is not applicable. And if one charge is in motion and the other charge is at rest, then what will be the case? In that case also, you can use Coulomb's law. Sorry. But if both the charges are in motion, then in that case, Coulomb's law is not applicable. So the second limitation is, only applicable when both the charges are at rest. If both charges are in motion, then not valid. Okay, and if one charge is in motion and the second one is at rest, first is in motion and second is at rest, then it is applicable. Okay, so these were the some of the limitations of Coulomb's law. Now we have discussed about the two charges, when they are in rest or they are in motion, or when one is at rest and one is in motion. Okay, so these three cases we have discussed. Now after that, this is only about two charges. What if there are multiple charges, that is more than one charges? So till now we have discussed one and two charges, but if there are two, three, four, five, six, if there are n number of charges, then how to calculate the forces between those two, or you can say any charge. Okay, so we are going to find how to find the charges on any, how to find the force on any charge when there are multiple number of charges present in the medium. Okay, so for that we need to discuss principle of superposition. Okay, so what does principle of superposition state? If there are, let's say for example, Q1, Q2, Q3, instead of 3, let us discuss for n number of charges, Q4, Q5 up to n. If there are n number of charges, then according to the principle of superposition, net force on, let's say, nth particle, net force on n particle is the vector sum of forces on individual charge. Or you can write it as Fn1, Fn2. Okay, you have to represent it as this, in this way. Okay, so what is Fn1? Force on nth charge due to 1. Force on nth charge due to 2. That is Fn2. In the similar way, we will write it as Fn4 up to Fn. Force on nth charge. The last will be force on nth charge due to n minus 1. Okay, so this, in this way we can calculate force on any charge. So suppose except n, if you want to calculate on any other charge, let's say for example Fq2, so for net force on charge q 2, then it will be the vector addition of force on charge 1 due to 2, 2 due, on 2 due to 1, then on 2 due to 3, then on 2 due to 4, and in the same way we have to add all the forces. Okay, so this is how we can calculate force on any charge because of the number of charges present in the surrounding. Okay, so we'll be solving some of the numericals on that. So first of all, let us write a simple statement. In a system of n charges, after this we will be discussing some of the numericals of n charges, the total electrostatic force on any charge is vector sum. So this statement you have to remember. By just remembering this formula, you can solve a number of numericals which are asked on principle of superposition. So if in a system of n charges, the total electrostatic force on any charge is the vector sum of forces due to all remaining charges. Okay, so let's say for example this is Q1, this is Q2, this is Q3, this is Q4. Okay, so if you want to, let's say for example, find on Q3. Okay, so you want to calculate on Q3. So let's say all are positive charges. Okay, so force on Q3 you have to calculate individually from for Q1. Then means how this Q1 charge is going to apply the force on Q3. Then how this force Q2 is going to apply force on Q3. So this will be F131 vector plus F32 vector plus F43 vector. So you are going to add all the forces, or you can say forces with its direction on the Q3, so as to get the net force on charge Q3. Okay, so we'll be solving the numericals on that. So we'll be clearly understanding how to calculate the forces. Okay, so remember that just now we have discussed four charges. Now after some time, let's say after time t, a new charge comes, that is Q5. Now because of that Q5 charge, the charges which were earlier coming on the charge Q3, they are not going to change. That is F31, F32, F34, they will not change because of that any new charge coming inside the system. Okay, the individual charges, or sorry, the individual forces between two charges are unaffected due to presence of other charges. Okay, so the individual force between any two charges are unaffected due to presence of other charges. Okay, so F, just now we discussed F1, 2, 3, 4, that the forces which were coming on the charge 3, so these forces are unaffected by the presence of any other charge. Okay so let's now first of all discuss two important terms, that is permittivity and relative permittivity, and after discussing this we will be solving few important numericals on this topic. Okay, so let us write down what is permittivity and relative permittivity. Okay, so let's first of all discuss what is permittivity. So here in this term, Fe, we just discussed F is the force between two charged particles, that is kq and q2 by r square, where we have discussed k, that is k is a constant and it depends upon the medium. The value of k is 9 into 10 raised to 9 and its unit is Newton meter square per Coulomb square in SI unit. Okay, but the formula of k as defined by Coulomb is 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0, where epsilon 0 is permittivity of vacuum. Okay, so let us discuss about it. So permittivity is, let's say if this is charge q1 and this is charge q2 and this is the distance between these two charges, now center to center distance between these two charges, we have discussed that force of attraction F is equal to k q1 q2 by r square. Now this k is nothing but 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0, and epsilon 0 is permittivity of vacuum. Now, instead of vacuum, if there is any other medium, then at this place of epsilon 0 will keep the permittivity of that medium. Okay, so we can derive from here that F is inversely proportional to permittivity of medium. So as permittivity increases, the force between two charges is going to decrease. So if we talk about vacuum, in vacuum there will be the maximum force between two charges. So if those two charges are placed of same magnitude and the distance is also kept constant, if those two similar charges are placed in any other medium apart from vacuum, then the force is going to change. Or in other words, if I say the force is going to reduce, because in vacuum there will be maximum force of attraction between those two charges. But if we keep the same two charges and keeping the distance same between them in any other medium, then the force is going to reduce, because more is the permittivity of medium, the lesser will be the force between those two charges. Okay, so if we draw the graph, we can say that as permittivity increases, the force is going to reduce. Okay, so minimum value is for vacuum, that is epsilon is equal to epsilon 0. Epsilon 0 means permittivity of vacuum, and its value is 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 12. The unit is coulomb square per newton meter square. Okay, because we know that we have defined K as newton meter square per coulomb square, and epsilon is or you can say K is equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon. The unit of epsilon will be exactly opposite of that of K. Okay, so we'll say force between two charges is maximum in vacuum. Now in your question they will give you the value of epsilon for different mediums, but sometimes they give you the value of relative permittivity. So let us discuss another term, that is relative permittivity. Relative permittivity is also called dielectric constant. Okay, so the term relative itself means that we are going to relate that value with some standard value. So if permittivity of any other medium is related with the permittivity of vacuum, then we are going to use the term relative permittivity. It is symbolized as epsilon r. Epsilon r is equal to permittivity of any medium divided by permittivity of vacuum. This is permittivity of any medium divided by permittivity of vacuum. Okay, so there can be, if it is given like for example epsilon r is equal to, let's say, 16, and for any liquid is given and its relative permittivity is 16. So epsilon l will be epsilon r times, where epsilon l is permittivity of that liquid, is epsilon r times the permittivity of vacuum. Okay, so we will say that epsilon l is equal to 16 times permittivity of that liquid, because we know that epsilon r is epsilon m to epsilon 0. So the force between two charges in that liquid will be 1 by 16 times the force between same two charges in vacuum. Okay, So this is how we can relate. So force will reduce by 16 times in liquid with relative permittivity of 16. Okay, so this is how you can calculate. So epsilon r is equal to epsilon l divided by epsilon 0 is equal to f 0 divided by f l. Okay, this is equal to 16. That's why you will say f l is equal to f 0 divided by 16. Okay, so you can also say this mathematically. Okay, so let's solve some numericals. Okay, so write down the first one. Okay, so yesterday we had discussed the topic quantization of charge. So based on that topic, we will solve one question. So the question is, can a charge of 8 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb be given to a body? So first of all, we'll start with simple questions, and after that we'll solve questions on Coulomb's law, then principle of superposition, and so on. Okay, so the first question is, can a charge of 8 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb be given to a body? So you can pause the video and you can first of all solve by yourself. Okay, so let's solve this question. We know that as per the quantization of charge, Q is equal to N times of E. So the charge on any body can be only the integral multiple of the fundamental charge. Okay, and the fundamental charge on electron is 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. So the charge given is Q is equal to 8 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. And we know that E is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. So N will be Q by E, that is equal to 5. So yes, n is an integer, phi is an integer. So we can say that this much charge can be given to a body. So this is how you will solve question. Okay, so now let's start solving some questions on Coulomb's law. So first of all, write down, find the ratio of electrostatic force to gravitational force for two electrons placed at some distance apart in air. So there are two electrons, they are placed at some distance, some random distance, for let's say for example r, in air, and we have to find the ratio of electrostatic force to gravitational force between those two charges. Okay, so let's start solving. These are the two particles, distance let's say between them is r. So these are two electrons. Now in the previous video I have given you the table in which the mass of electron, then charge on electron, then on proton and neutron, and all that we have listed. So you can learn that table, and from that you can remember the values of masses and electrons, masses and charges on electron, proton and neutron. So in this question we are given electron. So the charge on an electron is 1.6 into 10 to the power 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb, and mass of a single electron is 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. Okay, now why E and M are required? Because what is the formula of Fe? It is K Q1 Q2 divided by R square, and the formula of Fg is, that is Q ग्रेविटेशनल फोर्स बिटवीन टू इलेक्ट्रॉन्स इज इक्वल टू जी एम वन एम टू डिवाइडेड बाई आर स्क्वायर. सो फॉर दैट वी विल रिक्वायर क्यू वन क्यू टू एंड एम वन एम टू. नाउ इन दिस केस बोथ द पार्टिकल्स आर सेम और वी कैन से बोथ आर इलेक्ट्रॉन्स. सो क्यू वन क्यू टू विल बी इक्वल टू क्यू वन एंड क्यू टू विल बी इक्वल एंड एम वन एंड एम टू विल ऑल्सो बी इक्वल. बोथ आर सेम. इन क्वेश्चन देयर कैन ऑल्सो बी द रेशियो ऑफ लेट्स से इलेक्ट्रॉन एंड प्रोटोन और यू कैन से प्रोटोन एंड प्रोटोन. सो इन द सिमिलर वे डिफरेंट क्वेश्चंस कैन ऑल्सो बी फॉर्म्ड. ओके बट द क्वेश्चन इन द क्वेश्चन द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन द इलेक्ट्रॉन्स इज फिक्स्ड. ओके सो आर इज फिक्स्ड. नाउ द वैल्यू ऑफ के इज वी हैव रिटन इन प्रीवियस इन टुडेज लेक्चर 9 इंटू 10 रेज टू 9 न्यूटन मीटर स्क्वायर पर कूलम्ब स्क्वायर. एंड द वैल्यू ऑफ जी इज 6.67 into 10 to the power minus 11 newton meter square per kg. So we have all the values, just we have to keep these values and we have to find the ratio. So ratio of Fe to Fg will be k q1 q2 by r square divided by g m1 m2 by r square. Okay, so in this way you will calculate it and you will get a rough value of 10 raised to 42. So this shows that electrostatic force is 10 raised to 42 times stronger than gravitational force. So this is the value which shows how strong electrostatic force between two electrons is as compared to the gravitational force. So in general we are going to neglect gravitational force in comparison to electrostatic force. Okay, but if they have asked you about proton, then the mass on proton will be 1.67 into 10 to the power minus 27 kg. The charge is same but of opposite nature. Okay, so if they have asked you between proton and proton or electron and proton, then in that way also you can calculate the ratios. Okay, so let's write down the next question. A charge Q is divided in two parts such that when these two parts are kept at some separation the force between them is maximum. Find charge on each part. Okay, question is a charge is Q is divided in two parts such that when these two parts are kept at in separation, at that time the force between them, electrostatic force between them, is maximum, and we have to find the value of these two parts. Okay, so let's say this is Q1 and this is Q2, and let they be separated at a distance r. Okay, or let's say for example if it is Q, then in that case Q1 will be, let's say for example Q1 is equal to Q, then the other part will be Q2 equal to capital Q minus small q, because it is the both are the the parts of the total charge Q. Okay, so Q1 is equal to Q and Q2 will be Q minus Q. Okay, so it is said that the force is maximum. So F is equal to, first of all let us write the formula, k q1 q2 by r square एज पर द क्वेश्चन एफ इज मैक्सिमम, सो इन ऑर्डर टू गेट द मैक्सिमम वैल्यू डी एफ अपॉन डी एक्स विल बी इक्वल टू जीरो, और इन आर केस इट इज डी क्यू. ओके सो डी बाई डी क्यू ऑफ, वॉट इज द वैल्यू ऑफ एफ, के अपॉन आर स्क्वेयर, वैल्यू ऑफ क्यू वन इज क्यू, वैल्यू ऑफ क्यू टू इज कैपिटल क्यू माइनस स्मॉल क्यू, दैट इज इक्वल टू जीरो. सो लेट अस डिफरेंशिएट इट. सो इट विल बी डी बाई डी क्यू, के एंड आर स्क्वेयर आर कॉन्स्टेंट, सो दे विल कैन गो आउट एंड क्यू इंटू कैपिटल क्यू माइनस क्यू स्क्वेयर इक्वल टू जीरो डी बाई डी क्यू. सो दिस विल बी क्यू कैपिटल क्यू माइनस टू क्यू इक्वल टू जीरो. सो क्यू विल बी कैपिटल क्यू डिवाइडेड बाई टू. ओके सो वॉट इज क्यू, इट वॉज क्यू वन. सो द आंसर इज वैल्यू ऑफ क्यू वन इज इक्वल टू क्यू इज इक्वल टू कैपिटल क्यू बाई टू, एंड क्यू टू विल बी कैपिटल क्यू माइनस स्मॉल क्यू, सो इट विल ऑल्सो बी इक्वल टू क्यू बाई टू. So if we want to get the maximum force between those two charges, then we have to divide the total charge in exactly two equal parts. So Q1 is equal to Q2 is equal to Q by 2. Okay, so let's write down the next question. Okay, so now we'll be discussing questions on principle of superposition. So, the question is, find the F net on charge at vertex C. Okay, so I will draw the diagram and after that we'll calculate the net. Okay, so the charge distribution is in this way. This is A, this is B, this is C. At A there is plus Q charge, at B there is plus Q charge, and at C there is plus Q charge. Okay, and this is an equilateral triangle, so distance is fixed. Let's say for example A and A. And you have to calculate the net force on charge Q. Now, charge Q, which is placed at C. Now, according to the principle of superposition, we know that the F net on C is vector sum of net force on C due to A plus net force on C due to B. Okay, so first of all, let us find what is FCA and FCB. After that, we'll add it. FCA equal to, the formula is K Q1 Q2 by R square. So the charge is Q into Q. So Q square divided by R is A square. And if we calculate for FCB, the value will be again K Q into Q, Q square divided by A square. So let us call it as F. Now the charge on B and C is same, so the force, direction of force will be like this, FCB. And similarly on FCA, the direction will be like this. As the both charges are in of same nature, so they will be the force will be of repulsive in nature. Okay, so FCB and FCA, and the value of FCB and FCA are equal, that is equal to F. So now in 11th class we have studied how to find the vector sum. So if this is F, this is F, and the angle between them is, as this is equilateral triangle, so the angle will be 60 degree. Okay, so net, or you can say resultant force F, This will be the resultant force F net. Okay, so F net will be equal to bracket F1 square plus F2 square plus 2F1 F2. So F into F square cos theta, where theta is the angle between the two charges. Here it is 60 degree. Okay, so cos 60 is 1 by 2. So this and this will get cancelled out. So this will be equal to F square plus F square plus F square, 3F square, or you can say root 3F. So the net force is equal to root 3, where value of F is KQ square by A square. So KQ square by A square. This is how you can calculate. Now we have calculated for 3 charges. Now, instead of 3, if they have given you 4, 5, 6, any number of charge, in this way, you have to find for individual pair, and after that, you have to add all the pairs vectorially. Okay, so this is how we can calculate. Now, here in this case, there is plus Q, plus Q, plus Q. Instead of plus, you can also take minus, but in that case, there will be the force of attraction between those two charges, and in this way, you can calculate. Okay, let us solve one or two more questions on the same topic. Find F net on charge placed at center. Okay, so you have to calculate the net force on charge which is placed at center. So first of all, let me draw the diagram. So here there are 4 charges. This is plus Q, this is plus Q, this is plus Q, and this is plus Q. This is A, B, C, and D. Okay, and this is the center E, and here there is capital plus Q charge. So you have to find the net charge on the center, that is on plus Q plus capital Q charge, because of charges placed at A, B, C, and D. So let us first of all find the direction of all the charges, and after that we'll add them vectorially. Okay, so let us draw the directions of all the charges. So the force on point E due to charge placed at point A will be in, just we have to join the center. Okay, so this will be like this, F E A. Similarly, because of point D, it will be like this, F D E. Similarly, because of point B, charge placed on point B, it will be like this, F E B. Here it will be F E D. And because of charge placed at C, it will be like this, F E C. Okay, so here we can see that this is 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so if we see the magnitude, let's say, of FEA will be equal to K into small q, this is plus q, this is plus capital Q, into capital Q divided by distance between them is, let's say if this distance is A, so this distance will be A by 2, and this distance will also be A by 2, so this distance will be square root of A by 2 plus A by 2 square. Plus A by 2 square. Okay, so this will be k small q capital Q divided by root 2 a by 2. So it will be a by root 2. Okay, so but here if you see that the value of f e a will be equal to f e b will be equal to f e c will be equal to f e d. So if we see, then f e b is going to cancel out the force f e d, and f e c is going to cancel out the force f e a. Now in this case, this is the case in which all the charges are distributed symmetrically and value of all the charges is of same nature. Okay, in this case we can see that the net force is equal to F, the value of all the forces is equal. So the net force on Q will become zero. Okay, this is only because of symmetry. So you have to see that if all these forces are going to cancel out each other, then you do not need to solve. But even if you want to check, then you can find the value of all the forces, and after that you can resolve it. Okay, okay, so this is next question on your screen. So write down the next question. Now this question is about how to find the third charge in equilibrium. Now what does this question mean? In this types of question, they will give you two charges and they will ask you, where are you going to place the third charge so that the force on that third charge because of the other two charges is zero, or you can say the net force on that third charge is zero. Now those two charges can be of any nature. Sorry, negative, positive, 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 or negative, negative. There can be three possibilities. In all the three possibilities, they can ask you that where are you going to place the third charge so that the net force on that charge is zero. So let us take one example of that, and remaining two you can solve by yourself. Okay, so write down the question. The question is, where should we keep a third charge on the line joining two charges such that third charge is in equilibrium? Okay, so let us take the case in which, let's say this is plus Q charge, and here there is, let's say for example, plus 4 Q charge. Now in this case, the distance between them is capital L, and you have to find the position of third charge where the net force on that charge is going to be zero. Now there can be three possibilities. The charge can be placed on the left side of plus Q, it can be placed on right side of plus 4q, and it can be placed in middle. So let us explore all three cases. So let's say for example, in the first case, if we are considering that charge is placed at this point, then what will happen? Because of plus 4 plus q charge, the force on that charge, let's say for example, we assume that this charge, third charge, is of positive in nature, is positive in nature. So because of this plus q charge, the force will be in this direction, F1, and because of this plus 4q charge, the force will be in this direction. Okay, so if both the forces are in same direction, then in that case the net force cannot be zero. So in the same way, if we consider on this side, let's say if this is plus charge, positive charge, if we keep plus charge on right hand side of plus 4q, the F1 will be in this way because of the force of repulsion. F2 will also be in this direction. So in this way you can see that the direction of both the forces is the same. So in this case also the net charge cannot be zero. Now instead of plus charge you can also assume a minus charge. So let's say for example a minus q charge is kept. In that case the direction will just get opposite. Okay, so in this case also the net charge cannot be zero on both the sides. Let's say this is minus q charge. So this will be F1 and this will be F2. Okay, the size of arrow shows the magnitude of charge. As this is plus 4q charge, so force of attraction will be more, and as here the magnitude of charge is small, so the force of attraction will be small. Okay, and also the distance is also more, so also in that way also the force will be less. Okay, so in this case also the net force cannot be zero, so these two possibilities are not possible. So the only possibility is to keep this force here. So it will be, let's say, at x distance. If it is placed at an x distance from plus q charge, so in this case the force will be, let's say this is plus capital Q charge, so because of this there will be force of repulsion. This will be F1, and because of plus 4q charge this will be in this direction F2. In this case there is the possibility of getting net force as equal to 0. So this is x distance and this is L minus x distance. So now we have to calculate this x distance from which we can get the net force as 0. So let the distance be x from plus q charge. Okay, instead of positive charge you can also take negative charge. So if it is minus q charge, then there will be, the direction will get opposite, but in that case also the force, both the forces can, you can say, nullify the effect and net force can become zero. So we know that net force is equal to zero. For that F1 must be equal to F2. For that, what is F1? F1 will be K plus Q into capital Q divided by X square. And what is the value of F2? It will be K into plus capital Q into plus 4Q divided by L minus X square. Okay, so let us write down K to Q into capital Q divided by X square. And the other is K into 4Q into capital Q divided by L minus X square. So the value will be L minus X by X whole square is equal to 4. Okay, so just we have to solve this and we have to calculate the value of X. Now it's just a mathematical calculation. So L minus X upon X can be equal to 2, or value of L minus X upon X can be equal to minus 2. Okay, so in the first case the value of X will be equal to L by 3, and in this case value of X will be equal to minus L. You can solve it, you will get X equal to L by 3, or you can get X is equal to minus L. Okay, now we know that if X is equal to minus L, in that case the charge will get on the left side of plus Q charge, and that is not possible, that we have already verified. Okay, so these two possibilities are already gone. So there is only one possibility, that it can be between plus Q and plus 4Q charge, and that distance X is now equal to, this distance X is equal to L by 3, and this distance X, L minus X is L minus L by 3, so this is 2L by 3. Okay, this is let's say small. Okay, so this is how we will calculate it. Now this is not possible. Okay, so this x value of x is equal to l by 3. So this is how you will solve it. Now instead of plus q and plus 4q, they can ask you plus q and minus 4q. They can also ask you minus q and minus 4q, and they can also change the magnitude. In this way you can calculate all three cases, and you can check where the charge can be placed, on the left side, on the right side, or in the center. So this is how you can solve the questions. So that this is all for today's lecture. In the upcoming lecture we are going to discuss about electric fields. So thanks for listening to me peacefully, and have a nice day and stay healthy. Goodbye.